Jack, welcome back to Success. So great to have you here.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me, Darren.
So Jack, you come from a rather modest background. In the early years, did you have any inkling that your life would be as successful as it's turned out to be?
Well, I had no idea it would turn out like this. I grew up in West Virginia, used to play in coal mines as a kid. My dad made $8,000 a year working as a florist. And, I was fortunate that I really got early on that education was the way out of there. And so I worked really hard in school, graduated third in my class, and ended up on a scholarship at Harvard University. And two very synchronous events changed my life. My junior year, my roommate came back and said, I found a course that's an easy A. I said, okay, I'll take it. What is it? It was Social Relations 10, which was a psychology class. And I took it and I fell in love with human behavior. But I had not enough undergraduate courses in psychology to get into graduate school. So I ended up applying to be a teacher, went to the University of Chicago studying to be a teacher. And I taught in inner city high school for a year. And then I was in a laundromat minding my own business when a guy came up to me and said, put down your book and talk to me. I went, okay. So I started talking to him, and it turned out he was a graduate student in economics, and he was attending this lecture series up at Kendall College in Evanston, Illinois, called the Living Philosopher Series. And he asked me to come with him. So I said, okay. So I went to this series, and the first speaker was a man named Dr. Herbert Otto, who was a human potential expert. And at the end, I went up and I said, I am so blown away. I want to learn to do what you do. He said, well, you need to go to the W. Clement and Jesse V. Stone Foundation. They teach this stuff there in Chicago. So I ended up going to the Stone Foundation and ended up working for W. Clement Stone, who was a good friend of Napoleon Hill, who wrote Think and Grow Rich, and he wrote The Success System That Never Fails. And he started teaching me all of the things that are the core of what I still teach today about goal setting, affirmations, visualization, positive thinking, and so forth. And then he had me set a goal. He said, I want you to set a goal that's so big that if you achieve it, you'll know it's only because of me. So here's this kid whose father only made $8,000 a year, and I set a goal to make $100,000 in 1 year. And I didn't make $100,000, but it made $92,000 that year, and it totally changed my life. And that's when I began to dream big and think the kind of things I'm doing now were possible.
You know that W. Clement Stone is in my ancestry and Success's ancestry. He was once the publisher and owner of Success Magazine.
Well, I used to work at South Michigan in the foundation office. And Og Mandino, who was the editor back then, used to actually go up to his office at night because he was a late worker as well. And I was fortunate to have conversations with him when I was in my 20s. So I'm very aware of that background.
All three amazing men, Napoleon Hill, W. Clement Stone, and Og Mandino. So, Jack, you're taking a position as they had in the industry these days. We mentioned before we got started that this is an issue where we're featuring the most influential people in the personal development industry. I'm curious how you see your role within the personal development industry. What have been your goals and ambitions in coaching others?
Well, early on, I ended up with a life purpose statement that said to inspire and empower people to live their highest vision in the context of love and joy. And that's really what I see my work is about. I inspire people through things like the Chicken Soup for the Soul books, where the stories are people have overcome amazing obstacles, have loved more fully, taken more chances, and so forth. And then the empowerment is in books like The Success Principles, The Aladdin Factor, The Power of Focus, and so forth, where I teach people tools to actually empower them to live the life that they want. But it's a combination of inspiration and empowerment. And I think that that's been my major role, is to blend those two. So I think, you know, I've always been someone who wanted to make a difference and who's, you know, gone out there and tried to do it in all the different ways, from writing and tapes and seminars and organizations and so on.
Well, you've done a beautiful job, and you do it with a great heart, and we appreciate the contributions you've made to human potential and helping expand it. I am interested in this. You know, even the best experts have their own mentors, people that they look to for advice and understanding. You talked about W. Clement Stone, Napoleon, and Og Mandino. But tell us about the mentor or mentors that you have had in the past, and maybe that you have now as well, that have had a profound influence on you and your life.
Well, Stone was the first one, of course. And then I was in Chicago in the birth of the civil rights movement. You know, Jesse Jackson had a church there. And I had this friend who went to that church, and he invited me to go since I was teaching in an all-black inner city high school. And I went there every Sunday, and I watched a master at someone who learned how to move a crowd. He was an amazing orator. I remember this watching him one day. He was standing up on stage. His orchestra was playing, and he just did this slight nod over to the orchestra, and they stopped. And then he started preaching. And I thought, wow, I want to learn to do that. And that was really the basis of me now running intensive personal development trainings for as many as 800 people at a time over a course of a week. And I think that was, you know, critical to my believing that that kind of influence was possible. Martha Crampton was a woman nobody knows about, but she taught me to meditate. And it was through meditation that I got the title for Chicken Soup for the Soul, got the impetus to start the Transformational Leadership Council and so forth. So that was a huge piece of my, you know, mentoring and being mentored. And then Stuart Emery, who's a friend of mine now, was the CEO of Est at one point, and later his own company called Actualizations. And he taught me all how to run a business when you're working with, you know, large group trainings. And then John Gray, who's a friend of mine, has really been a mentor to me, both in two ways. Number one, I took a seminar with him, and it was the result of that that I started my own training company. It empowered me to do that. And also has been a mentor to me in the whole area of health and nutrition, and has taught me that consciousness has to be supported by proper nutrition or the brain chemistry won't work. Guys like Daniel Amen have come along and others that have built on that, JJ Virgin and so forth. So I am a constant learner, as you know, and if I listed everyone who's influenced me, we'd be here for an hour.
Well, one of the things I always admire about you, Jack, is that you give conferences, you attend conferences, and you're the guy that's taken the most notes.
Mm-hmm.
I always watch you, and I'm competing with you without your knowledge to see if I can get more of the notes down than you. It's always like the people who need to learn the least or seems to be the ones that are more ravenous about learning, and I appreciate that quality in you because I pursue it myself. Now, we talked about mentors. It seems to be a question I'm asked a lot, and there's a lot of confusion around the idea, I think. What would be your thoughts on how one goes about finding a mentor, what the expectations should be from the mentee, and how the mentee should act and interact with a mentor in order to utilize that resource to its highest potential? What are some of your suggestions in that topic?
Well, I think mentors are really important, and I think it's important for the mentor as well as the mentee. But I think that if you want to find a mentor, the main thing is to simply ask yourself, who would I like to learn from? Who is somebody who's doing what I want to do? And then I think if you approach them, the people that have been successful getting me to mentor them are people that have said, could I get 10 minutes of your time a month? It's really hard to say no to someone who's asking for 10 minutes. Now, that 10 minutes invariably turns into a half-hour phone call, an hour phone call, come and visit me for a day, whatever. But the idea is that I am not feeling overwhelmed by the request. Another thing you can do is invite people to take them out for a meal because they have to eat anyway. One of my friends said, can I buy a ticket next to you next time you fly on a plane and sit next to you and just grill you for a couple of hours? And the person said yes. So there's a lot of ways to go about it. The better, when you are a mentee, the main thing is do what your mentor tells you. Let them know that you did it. Now, obviously, if they tell you something you simply can't, you know, support ethically or legally or whatever, don't do it. But basically, let them know that you're having an influence on them. Also, give back to them in some way. Ask them how you can serve them. It's greatly appreciated when there's something that comes back to you. They know then that you're using what they are teaching you and you're appreciative for it.
Let's talk about how you prepare yourself. You've got a heavy load of making a great contribution to a lot of people. You're still having a big impact on a lot of people, both directly and indirectly. What do you do daily to be sure that the impact you're having is always a positive one?
Sure, a couple of things. You know, Deepak Chopra once said that every morning he prayed for being of greater service to a greater number of people that day. And I thought that was really great. So I kind of made that my morning mantra. You know, how can I be of greater service to a greater number of people today? And the other thing I do is what I call the hour of power, 20 minutes of meditation, 20 minutes of aerobic exercise or lifting weights, and then 20 minutes of reading. Now, my reading usually extends beyond that 20 minutes, but I've read over 3,000 books in my lifetime. And what happens is that I am committed to having, you know, more consciousness, more health, and more wisdom in those three of the ways that I do that. I do visualizations and affirmations every morning for my goals. I exercise, as I mentioned. I eat well. I make sure I get enough sleep. I do yoga, take a lot of vitamins and minerals, and keeps me energized and focused and ready to go.
As you know, Jack, I mean, one of the most consistent qualities amongst high achievers are that they are lifelong learners. They're just ravenous in their desire to kind of get the edge, learn, grow, expand their knowledge, try, iterate. And this is obviously something we've talked about already, about your discipline towards it. But fill us in on your why behind your personal commitment to it, and then maybe even expand on it to inspire others to get more committed to it. You know, why do you do it? What's the outcome? And what would you do to impress upon somebody else that they probably need to dig a little deeper when it comes to their desire and time and energy focused towards personal growth and learning?
Well, in my book, The Success Principles, I have a chapter called Learn More to Earn More. And I think Jim Rohn, as you know, and a good friend of yours, is someone who inspired all of us to say, hey, if I want my net worth to go up, my self-worth has to improve. So I need to work on myself. I need to become more competent. You know, constantly said, if you want to make more money, produce more value. Well, you produce more valuable by having more skills, more things you can share, more ideas, more insights, more awareness, more wisdom. And so for me, I'm a voracious learner. I mean, I have to force myself to go to bed at night and not watch another TED Talk on YouTube, or not read another book, or skim another website, or watch another video. I'm just constantly wanting to know more and do more and do better. And I have a little mantra that goes, I want to go further and faster with less effort. So I'm always looking for what's the way to do it faster and go quicker, to go further than people thought they could go.
Now, Jack, we can't let a whole interview go by without getting your opinion on some of the more current and important areas of success and personal development that people are dealing with today. Let's start with the latest happiness movement. Give us your perspective on it, how it plays into people's overall success goals, and if it's something that you think is making a difference.
I think it's great. Everything that a person does is because they think they're going to experience something good as a result of it. So if I exercise, I'm going to experience living longer, living healthier, being pain-free, not getting sick, etc. So even when I remember when I first learned this, that what we're always seeking is an experience that we think something is going to give us. So we're looking for that happiness, that joy, that inner peace. And I remember I was doing a training, and we had to do an exercise called What Do You Want? And then What's the Experience You're Looking For? And I remember saying, I want a Mercedes. And then, what's the experience you're looking for? Well, I want to be able to pull up to the light in Santa Monica, where I was living at the time, and not be in an old jalopy when everyone else was in a Lexus, a Mercedes, and a BMW. Well, what was the experience? I wanted to belong. Well, what was the experience I was looking for in belonging? Well, then I could be myself. I could relax. I could be happy. So it's almost always going back to, we want to experience happiness, joy, freedom, and peace. And so, you know, a lot of us thought, the old motto was have, do, be. If I have a lot of money, I can do what rich people do, and then I'll be happy. And what we're finding today, if I be happy first and do the things happy people do, I will attract everything I want to have. And so basically, I think this movement of happiness and the positive psychology movement, all of that is great. And what it's proving is it's not about self. We find that the greatest giver, the greatest production of happiness occurs when I'm serving others, when I'm serving a purpose beyond my own self-interest. I'll give you a quick story that I wrote about in my new book. Kenneth Baring is worth about $600 million. He was at one time the owner, part owner of the Seattle Seahawks football team, and he was very unhappy. And he thought if he had all the right things, he would be happy. So he went through four stages of his life, he said, when I heard him speak. He said, number one, I thought stuff was going to do it. So he called the first stage stuff. He said, I had all the right stuff. Had the car, the house, the plane, all of that, wasn't happy. And the second stage was called better stuff. So he bought a bigger house, a bigger plane, a bigger car, a bigger boat, bigger TV set. He said, I still wasn't happy. And then he said the third phase was different stuff. He said, that's when I bought the Seattle Seahawks football team with a couple of friends, thinking if I owned a football team, could sit in the box, go down to the dressing room and then the playing field, I would be happy. And he said, I wasn't. And then someone called him and said, would you be willing to come on my private jet? We're going to give away 40 wheelchairs. I think it was Bosnia-Herzegovina, someplace like that, over in Europe, where there was a war going on and kids were losing their legs to landmines and so forth. So he got on the plane, he went there, and he was picking up one of the kids and putting them into a wheelchair. This little boy started to cry, and then he wouldn't let go of his leg. So here's Ken trying to leave, and he can't get away. And finally, through an interpreter in tears, the boy said, please don't leave yet. I want to memorize your face. So when we meet again in heaven, I can thank you one more time. And Ken said at that moment in time, his total life changed. He said, I felt pure joy for the first time. And he came back and he started the Kenneth Baring Wheelchair Foundation. He also builds wells in Africa. He's given over 40,000 wheelchairs away. He's extremely happy. He said, all that money didn't make me happy, but giving it away to do something meaningful did. That plus having a strong social community and being in a state of constant gratitude gives you the core of happiness. And when you're doing that, as a person who wants to be more successful, people are attracted to happy people. People want to be around you. They want that same experience themselves. So it actually is a great part of success.
So it was stuff, bigger, different, and what was the fourth? How did he term the fourth phase?
Purpose. The last stage of his life, he said, was purpose.
Purpose. Beautiful. So now here's another thing, Jack. You know, distraction, huge factor in people's lives and businesses today. We seem to grow ever more distracted by the day with this constant change in technology and things that are coming at us. Talk about how you handle distraction and give us some of your best guidelines for overcoming it in our lives.
Well, I think you have to control the input into your life, just like you control the amount of food, the amount of alcohol, et cetera, that you put into your life. I once had a doctor say the only thing that makes people sick is too much of what they don't need and not enough of what they do need, meaning vitamins, minerals, water, food, et cetera. So basically, a distraction is something we call them shiny objects in our office. You know, things come along, new opportunities. It's a shiny object. But you have to be clear about what is your purpose? What are your priorities? You know, what's the vision? What's the mission? What are you chosen to do? What are your goals? And then you have to have habits and rituals and routines to help you get there. And anything that's outside of those habits, rituals, and routines, you want to basically keep to the side. Then you can surround yourself and protect yourself with policies, procedures, your secretary, your email address, all those kind of things to keep those distractions from coming in. I mean, I went on a what I called a digital detox a while ago, where I stopped opening all my email myself. I have my staff do that, only give me what I needed to see. I remember W. Clement Stone, my mentor, had he had about 20 secretaries just open his mail, and then they would write summaries and give them to him what they thought he needed to see that they couldn't answer. And also for me, I have a rule that the first 2 hours of the morning, I only do my top priority goals. In other words, a lot of people come in the first 2 hours are answering emails and drinking coffee, talking to people, telling jokes, catching up, and you're not really focused on your goals. You're being distracted by other people and their goals. So, you know, Dan Sullivan, who runs the Strategic Coach Program, divides your days into focus days, free days, and buffer days. And so a focus day for me is midnight to midnight with 80% of my activity focused on my top priority goals. A buffer day, and I try to keep those to a limit, are days where I'm doing things like training, delegating, going to a conference, traveling. And then free days are days midnight to midnight where it's just me, my wife, my family, having fun, doing things, no emails, no phone calls, no business reading. And when you divide your life into those kind of segments and you honor them and you actually do them because you've planned it rather than being by default, being distracted by other people, life gets very, very magical.
So some great advice in there, just chock full of it. So now, Jack, in your studies and teachings, you've certainly identified what it takes to be successful, but talk about what people struggle with. What leads them to being unsuccessful? Open our eyes to the areas that sometimes cause us the most grief on our journey to success without even realizing. What should we be on the constant lookout for?
I think the big things are our unconscious limiting beliefs. Whenever you set a goal, three things come up: your considerations, which are your beliefs, your fears, and external roadblocks. And so the purpose of setting a goal is to create mastery so you can handle your beliefs, handle your fears, and overcome the roadblocks. And most people don't set big goals, or when they do, those fears, considerations, and roadblocks come up, and then they see those as stop signs and they give up. So for me, I think some of the most powerful work I do in my work with others and in my own life is working on identifying what those limiting beliefs are around money, about relationships, about sex, about making a difference in the world, about religion, and so forth, so that I can be free of those and be totally 100% present all the time with whoever I'm with in the moment. Fear is a big one for people. We have fear of asking, fear of rejection, fear of failure, fear of loss of money, loss of fame and fortune and reputation. So we really have to learn how to manage fear. And fear is all created by having beliefs that something bad's gonna happen in the future. So if we can learn to stay in the present. And another big thing is our inner critic. Many of us have an inner critic voice that was, you know, the voice we took on from our parents and teachers and coaches and so forth when we were younger. We have to learn how to transform our inner critic into an inner coach. And I have a whole chapter in my book, The Success Principles, that teaches people how to do that. I think the other big thing is we live in a culture of do it yourself, you know, the great Western, you know, self-made man. We've got to overcome that. I think most people don't ask for feedback. They're afraid of feedback. So that's another thing that's critical to success, is to get over our fear of feedback. I always say, if you don't ask your wife on a scale of 1 to 10, what's the quality of our relationship and how can we improve it so it makes it a 10, you're the only one who doesn't know. She's told her mother, her sister, the people at the nail salon, the people in the checkout line at the supermarket. So basically, as Ken Blanchard once said, feedback is the breakfast of champions. And a lot of people are afraid of what they're going to hear. so they don't ask for feedback. And so I think those are some of the key things that really stop people from being more successful.
Again, a highly compact answer of great suggestions there. Just that one Sunday review on a scale of 1 to 10 that I've used since our, well, probably a couple of interviews ago, Jack, has made such a transformational difference in the relationship with my own wife. So just, again, that was a little flyby that you did there on that one, but just that one idea is profound.
Just to unpack that so everyone knows, my wife and I, every Sunday, we sit down and we ask each other the question on a scale of 1 to 10, how would you rate the quality of our relationship? Anything less than a 10 gets the follow-up. What would it take to make it a 10? And that has radically transformed my relationship, not just with my wife, but I also do that in my company with my employees and with my clients.
Yeah, no, it's amazing. So we're referring to your last book, The Success Principles. What would you go back and change? You probably, like me, it's when I finish an issue or I finish a book, you know, you close the door and you look forward. You don't contemplate what could have, should have been. But if you were to do a volume 2 and you were to add a couple of few principles that you've had epiphanies with since the book, or that you'd like to add or you'd like to now expand on, what would be one or two that you would include in, say, volume 2?
Well, I love this question because it's almost like it was prepared, but you don't know this, but literally this month in January, the 10th anniversary revised edition of the Success Principles is coming out. And what we've done to upgrade that book is a couple of things. Number one, in the first book, all the stories, like the one I told you about Kenneth Baring, were stories that were by other people that had not known me necessarily. They just illustrated the principles. But now most of the stories in the book are by people who actually read the first book, applied the principles, and have had their lives work in amazing ways. What we've added to the book, in addition to that, is a chapter on the law of attraction. We've added in tapping, a chapter on leadership, be the kind of leader people would want to follow, and then three chapters on success in the digital age, which is, you know, how do you use social media? How do you use crowdfunding, crowdsourcing, things like that in order to highly leverage yourself? I don't know if you've been following, but this Coolest Cooler campaign on Kickstarter, guy raised over $10.3 million. So we now know that nobody has the reason to say it's not possible to do anything. So the digital age has really changed things. We have a chapter on networking by Ivan Meisner, and I've added a chapter on mindfulness by a guy named Dawa Phillips, who's a meditation teacher. We've updated all the resources, and it's just, the book is so much better. It has all of the things that I've learned over the 10 years that since I wrote the book. And like you, I know you finish that book and 5 days later you want to add something to it, but you have to say, no, it's done. But fortunately, you get the chance when you revise it to bring it up to date. I'm really excited about the new edition.
Fantastic. So to try to sum all this up, to take a 30,000 foot view of kind of what this looks like for you, as your parting sort of hope for how you're remembered, how are you living to ensure that memory, and how should we sort of set our own lives up to point towards our desired lasting impact? What do you want that sort of summary statement about you to be, and what do you advise others do to kind of set that North Star and make sure that they're always sort of headed towards it and guided well along the way?
You know, one of the great exercises that people often do in these trainings is to imagine your own funeral, what your eulogy would be, or what you'd have on your gravestone. And I look at my gravestone and said, here lies Jack Canfield, someone who loved unconditionally, lived fully, served greatly, made a huge difference, and had a lot of fun doing it. And so that's really what I want my life to have been about. And so to assure that, I work on myself consistently, take a lot of seminars and read a lot of books, schedule growth into my life. My wife and I are actually going to India in February for 2 weeks on a spiritual pilgrimage. I'm taking seminars and always getting certified in new things and training thousands of trainers, as I said, and leaving a video and a written legacy both online and in the libraries. And so I'll continue to keep doing that until I die. I never see myself retiring. I only see myself maybe slowing down a little bit to have a little more fun along the way. But that's what my life is committed to.
Well, Mr. Jack Canfield, this has been fun. And I just want to say on behalf of Success, we appreciate the contribution you're making to personal development, to human achievement, and to making this a much better world for the rest of us to enjoy. Thank you for being with us, and thanks for